our DJs. Most people are DJs.
Hello and welcome to Most People Are DJs, the podcast of indie music and pop culture. My name is Michael O.D., and on this episode, it's been a little while, and we're going to make it mostly music. I'm going to be covering a couple of 80s bands, Tears for Fears and Peter Hook of Peter Hook and the Light, formerly of New Order. I'll be playing music by, and the music's new stuff, Argonaut and X-Cops. Let's start out with Tears for Fears, and I'm going to talk about their album, Songs from the Big Chair. We're going to go way back in time here, way back to when the album came out in 1985, 86. It's celebrating its 30th year anniversary this year in 2000. Well, I'm saying this year. It's actually 2015 that it turns 30 years old, but they were putting it together in 1984. This album, Tears for Fears, Songs from the Big Chair, had a huge impact on my life. And it all goes back to a story that one of the stories from my teenage years that I'll never forget. And it's probably one of my best teen memories. I had a girlfriend who, who actually was really into good music. Like, she actually turned me on to Sonic Youth and some other bands, the Chameleons. So she was, at that time, probably more hip into music than I was. And she was one of the first people to buy the Tears for Fears album, Songs from the Big Chair. And I remember she bought it. She told me she had it. And not only that, she told me she had it. And her mom wasn't home, which meant the house was empty. So I figured out a way to get over there. This was actually before I could drive. No, wait a minute. I actually had my license. I could drive, but it was early. I had not had my license for too long. So I came to see her at her house. Her parents weren't home. And we put the record on. And then we went to her room for a while the record was playing. We could hear the record. And let's just say, things transpired from there. But we really liked the record. And it was an album, so when the first side was over, you had to actually turn the record over. You had to take a moment out and go downstairs, turn the record over, leave the room, turn the record over, and then return to whatever you're doing. And we listened to that record 3 or 4 times that day. The funny thing was, and it's a great record. I'm going to go through track by track and talk about some of the songs and how through time it's kind of carried on with me, and it's probably in my top 10 albums. After a few listens, actually, a car pulled in the driveway and it was her mom, and I wasn't supposed to be there, and I definitely wasn't supposed to be there when she wasn't there. So I ran out to my car, and I don't know how I pulled this off, but I managed to pull out before she pulled in, and I was driving away, and I ran into a ditch somehow. I remember running into a ditch and not being able to get out. I actually had this VW. It was one of those VW vans, one of those real ugly hippie vans that I was driving. And I was stuck in this ditch and I couldn't get out on a road, which was causing me even more panic. There were some workers on a roof. They were putting together on a roof. Right where I happen to be always get lucky like this, but right where I was stuck. So I asked them, can you guys help me push me out? And they're like, sure, if you can get us a beer. Well, I'm only 16, just turned 16. Can't get you beer. I'd really like it if you guys could push me out. They pushed me out, and I got home. And that made it a really memorable day. But going back to Tears for Fears, Songs from the Big Chair, that album, Songs from the Big Chair, was taken from the... the album was called Songs from the Big Chair because of the movie Sybil. In the movie Sybil, when she's talking to her psychiatrist, and she can only feel comfortable when she's in this comfy chair and she's allowed to be herself. They were taking that theme and saying that with this album, we're going to put together songs with a bunch of different personalities to them, but a bunch of comforting songs in some ways. This is their second album. Their first album, I think it was called The Hurting. It had some good songs on it. They were more of a synth-pop duo at that time. This album sounds like much more than a synth-pop duo. This sounds like a pop band, a full, large-sounding... In fact, when it came out, it was one of the best-produced, large-sounding albums that I had come across. Just really, really good big sound on it. And this is, again, second album. Most of the time, the second album is very difficult for a band to do. Well, not the case for them. And in fact, this was kind of one up their last album by 10 times, maybe 100 times. Had their biggest pop songs on it. They've never recaptured the glory they had from Songs from the Big Chair, Which, you know, I guess some people look back and say, well, you know, they could never do it again. It's like, you know what? So few bands go that far, achieve that amount of success. You've got to give them credit for that, not say stuff like, well, they never really did it again. It's so hard to do that. And to do it once is amazing, and I think kind of a big thing in itself. So let's get to the songs. Shout opens it up, and Shout's a big pop anthem that everybody's heard. It's a great anthem, though. Like, I'm not big into anthem songs, but this one is all about kind of rejecting authority, rejecting the way things are, and expressing yourself. So Shout's very good. The Working Hour, after that, follows into kind of a mellow track. A mellow track with, like, a big opening to it. 2 minutes with a percussion and saxophone. Really nice opening that, in the early days, when I heard the track, I thought, I didn't think much about it. It just didn't strike me as a great song. When I think about it now, it's like almost like I've matured. It's a mature song. I really like the song now. Really like it. And one of the best songs. The vocals kick in, and they got this great kind of, it's both calming and alarming at the same time. The next track was the biggest pop song of the album. And it's probably one of the ones I like least. That's Everybody Wants to Rule the World, just because it sounds like a basically an adult pop song, front to back, start to finish. It doesn't really do a lot for me, but it did a lot for them. I mean, it was, I think, it wasn't number one, but it was in the top five, I think, at least. And it's been covered since then. Lord does a recent cover for Hunger Games of the song. People like the track. The next song is my favorite song of the record. And what it's called my jam of the album. That's Mother's Talk. Mother's Talk is an unbelievable song with a great groove that just pulsates with just funk and innovation. The album, it's fun. The original U.S. album, I think that they were trying to be too careful with it. They put a shorter version of this track down to like 3 minutes and 53 seconds on the U.S. version, whereas the U.K. version was on for 5 minutes. And it could go on forever for me because I just love the track so much. It's got such a rhythm to it. So there is on this 30th version that's been released, there's like a 9-minute version. There's like a 10-minute version. Great remixes of Mother's Talk. Just a tremendous. Cannot talk about how much I like that song. And still, I'll do DJ sets where I always have to throw in Mother's Talk. And it gets everybody going. I believe, big contrast to Mother's Talk. It immediately got quiet. Much slower song, very meditative. And some of the lyrics I like in it, he says in the song, "I believe if you thought for a moment, took your time, you would not resign yourself to your fate." So it's a good song. It's one of those, again, it's another song that over time I like better now than I did back then. I thought it was maybe a little boring back then. The next two songs go together, and there's no other way around it. Even though sometimes Head Over Heels is played without Broken, I can't do it. Those two songs got to be played together. Broken's an amazing intro and outro to it. Really just building fast stuff. And then it goes into Head Over Heels, really sweeping, epic song. The movie Donnie Darko is what really made me appreciate it, Head Over Heels, because they do a great montage scene. One of my favorites is the montage scene from Donnie Darko with Head Over Heels, and they're doing the opening of him walking into school, and his sister is doing a little cheerleading thing to it. It's amazing, the montage, best. So Head Over Heels is always, you know, before then I liked this song, after then I love this song. It's one of the best tracks off it, that and Mother's Talk. Head Over Heels, it maybe in the chorus it sounds like it's a little maybe too smart, what's the word, smarmy, smaltzy, maybe a little too poppy, but the ending just breaks down in this great recap of Broken. The actual album closes with Listen. Listen is probably my most frustrating track on it. It's a difficult thing to listen to. It sounds like it's a live track. Originally, I thought it was live. It's not live. It's this weird studio song that's almost ambient. It's over 7 minutes long, and it feels tedious. I still can't quite get the song. I do like it. I still like it, and again, one of the songs I like more. Out of 8 songs, they have like 3 songs that maybe I don't like so much. It's amazing how much this album, actually, I still put in my top 5, top 10, is one of the best albums ever made. Nonetheless, this song, I'm starting to like it more the more I listen to it. I'm trying to force myself to, and the more I do that, actually, the more I find things about it I do like. It's got a lot of little elements about it that are kind of neat. The song Songs from the album Songs from the Big Chair, originally released, and most people actually probably don't even know, there is a song called The Big Chair that wasn't on it. It's an instrumental. It's a pretty good instrumental. I think they should have included it. Could have taken the place of Listen. There are some other B-side tracks that are pretty good. The whole thing comes from a huge release. That this 30th anniversary version is like, it's five CDs. Then there's an extra CD. There's an extra DVD with live with tracks on it. There are live tracks on it. There are remixes. If you don't have it and you love the album, I mean, this is a great thing for the collector of it. There are different versions. There's a shorter version that is out that you can get as well. I definitely recommend like trying to get, if you don't have Songs from the Big Chair, you got to get the record. I mean, I know that time has gone by, Tears for Fears, you may not think of them like the band they once were, but it's one of those albums. I mean, people look at the White Album as the album of the 60s, right? There's probably definitely a couple of the 70s that people think of song albums of the 70s. This is an album of the 80s that I think you have to have. You have to have it in your collection if you're any fan of the 80s at all, and everybody should be a fan of the 80s. So I'm going to leave it at that. Just came out. It's something I think you should get and means a lot to me. I'm going to play a track now. And this track is by the band Argonaut. It's called You Don't Need a TV. That's what they're expressing in the song. They're thinking that TV just takes us away from being creative. I like TV. Obviously, you hear me talk about it a lot, but I understand the point that, you know, take a day off from TV. They're actually, we're saying, and you're going to hear this probably after November 24th, but they want to declare Monday, November 24th as Turn Your TV Off Day and do something creative. So maybe take a day off and do that. I try to do that every now and then, especially in the evening. I think at least one evening a week, I try not to turn it, have the TV on so that I can focus on things. They have this band is a five-piece band, and they're compared to Sonic Youth and a few other bands. They got kind of a punky poppy feel to them. I like it. Female lead singer. And their release is out in February. So this is kind of like one of their early songs. And they have a video for it that's kind of fun to watch as well. I'll put a link in for that. Argonaut, You Don't Need a TV. That was Argonaut, You Don't Need a TV. And I've got a couple of podcast affiliates for this episode that I want to talk to you about. And one is GoDaddy. I talk about them almost every episode because I've got tremendous deals with GoDaddy. I've got a great one coming. I have a new offer coming up. And if you just pay attention to my website, like the next couple weeks, you'll see a new GoDaddy offer come up. I got to hold off on that one, though, until it actually does. Until then, if you need to use GoDaddy, I've got a promo code, DJOff30, that will get you 30% off any new product order. That's a good deal, 30% off any new product order. And DJ12 will get you economy hosting for $1 a month for 12 months, which I know is a good deal because a lot of people use it. Both these, a lot of people use. GoDaddy, you know, it's still the easiest place to go to, you know, one of the best places to go to get your URL. I have a lot of codes for them at my website, mostpeoplearedjs.com. Just look for their logo on the right-hand side of the page. And the next podcast affiliate, I've got one more I want to tell you about, and that's because I love audiobooks, and I've gotten more into them. The most recent audiobook I'm listening to is Conan, The Conan Stories by Robert E. Howard. And yeah, these were written in the 1920s. Man, they're a lot of fun to listen to. I'm actually learning that for years I've pronounced things wrong, or at least differently than what the way the narrator's pronouncing them. But fantastic stories of Conan. That, and I get that at audiobooks.com. Audiobooks.com, when you sign up there, you can use the promo code TECH2, T-E-C-H-2, and you get two free audiobooks to keep and listen to. Audiobooks.com, you can find that logo as well as my website, and click on it and you get all the info. The next 80s person that this episode is called The Past is Present. So the next 80s star that is still around today, kicking it and doing things in a tremendous way, is Peter Hook. Peter Hook and the Light. I talked about Peter Hook probably, a couple years ago. Well, maybe it's only been about a year and 3 months or so ago. He toured here. He's the bass player of the band New Order. He plays, and if you listen to New Order, you know that one of the spotlights, one of the highlights of the band, which most people think of as a kind of dance synth band of New Wave, was the bass lines. Really, really cool bass lines in their songs. And Peter Hook is the person responsible for them. It all goes back to a story. Most people know the story that Peter Hook, he was kind of cut off from New Order. It really, without even hardly any word about it, he was unceremoniously kicked out of the band when they toured a couple years ago and just didn't tell him about it. He found out and he put together his own band, The Light, which he's done different things with. Peter Hook has done things since New Order, Band Revenge, which really good record. Another band at Monaco, good stuff. So he put together this band called Peter Hook and The Light and traveled out, and they did Movement and Power Corruption Lies. I saw that tour last year. Really great tour. Got me really excited. Got me one of the best shows of the year. Played for 2.5 hours. Now he's coming back. You know, so he came back last week. I went and saw him, and my expectations were high. See, last time he came, I didn't know what to expect. So I just said, well, you know, it's Peter Hook. He's playing some New Order tunes. I'll check it out. This year, he's not only coming out again playing New Order stuff, but he's playing their two best albums. Those albums, the two best in my mind, Low Life and Brotherhood. I think things kind of fall off right off the map after Brotherhood, but Low Life and Brotherhood, he's going to play those two, which are way more produced. The sound is a lot different. Lots of the different things going on in those records. He's going to tour with those two records. But I know he's so good from last time I saw him. My expectations are way high that this is going to be a great show. A lot of other people felt that way too, because it sold out immediately. Quickly sold out. And we were a jam-packed show at the Magic Bag. Peter Hook does not travel with an opening band because he opens with some Joy Division tracks. Last time he opened with a longer Joy Division set that had a lot of really good stuff in it. This one was a shorter Joy Division set with some obscure tunes in it. Some that I'm not even sure I recognized. A couple that I did. But then he transitioned right into the New Order material. First, he went back to an EP that came out before Low Life that had These Like Us on it. These Like Us is a great song. I knew right now we're off for a good show. Really good bass line. His name is Jack, plays bass with him. They go duo back and forth. Then instead of going into Low Life, he actually chose to go into Brotherhood. Because Brotherhood, I mean, when I put the two records back next to each other, I think that Low Life is a better record. In fact, I think it's a much better record, though I like Brotherhood. I mean, Brotherhood's got some good stuff on it, but it doesn't have, to me, the impact that Low Life has. So I think he was right to put that one first in front of it, and kind of went through the Brotherhood tracks fairly quickly, but they were good. And not only that, some of the things that people say, you know, well, he doesn't have Bernard, you know, he doesn't have this, the lead singer, Bernard Sumner, with him. So it can't be the same. Well, obviously it's not the same. I have to think that it's better. I haven't seen New Order, and I haven't seen them recently to compare it to. And I know maybe sometime they come around, I will. But what Peter Hook does is he takes these songs and he puts a rawness and an edge to it that New Order, I think, with their polish could never do. So he puts this rawness into it. And then the complicated, you think these songs is complicated. He actually takes them as takes them back to simplicity to it and removes some of the things from it, some of the textures to it, and adds some other elements. You know, I mean, they'll do the cowbell thing live that just works out during The Perfect Kiss. He has this little drum thing that he plays at certain times of the show that really works out. It's really cool the way he does things. His voice is not the same as Bernard Sumner's, but it's close. I mean, I'm surprised how close it is. However, what helps him out is that he has a guitarist that sings parts of Bernard Sumner's parts. And his vocals are a little higher than Peter Hook's, and they're really close. I mean, they are almost spot on at times. And they will harmonize together at times, and it sounds, I would almost say, better. That's maybe going too far, but I will say the songs are better because the building bass lines that he does and just the energy that he's put into his show, it's so good. Everybody that goes just can't get enough of it. I mean, I watched a girl just dance nonstop the entire show. I didn't watch her the entire show, but I did glance over and say, well, she's still dancing, like dancing hard at Peter Hook and his band. The low-life stuff was tremendous. I mean, Perfect Kiss was just so good. They would do these endings to the songs, these extended endings that would go on for a couple minutes, and the bass lines would trade off, guitars, everything would just go louder, and he'd play the bass right in the stage's face, basically just ram it down our throats, and it was amazing. I mean, I took some great photos. There are photos up on my website. There is a review up at the website that you can check out as well, kind of a full review. I pretty much told you everything the review says, but nonetheless, you could go back and read it if you wanted to. Came back on stage, did True Faith, which he had left off the Brotherhood Out record, and came back and did that in the encore. True Faith, and then he did Temptation, which everybody wanted to hear. And then he closed out with Blue Monday. Played for 2.5 hours again, 11:30 at night on a Thursday, and my ears were ringing the next day. And one of the things that I should have mentioned earlier in the review is that it was loud. I mean, I go to a lot of shows, so I think my ears have gotten some where they could stand a lot of loud shows without much of without them really being impacted very much. This one, it was kind of like, wow, this is loud. And I wasn't even up at the very front. I was actually back a bit where there's an elevation thing where I can take photos with the lens that I use better. So, but there it was still really loud. In fact, a couple people actually moved back, but you couldn't move back in the action. I definitely couldn't. One of the best shows of the year. It's November, so I can definitely say that. Feel pretty good about that. I'm not going to see a whole lot better than that. The moving into and the closing out the episode, got one more song. And this song is by X-Cops. When I first heard the name X-Cops, I thought for sure it was just a punk band. And then they were warming up. They actually warmed up recently for a show, and I didn't end up going to it. But I wish I had. Wish I had gone and seen X-Cops play, because it's a really cool band. It's a male and a female. One is from North Carolina, and then the other member, I think she's from I want to say Switzerland, but it's not Switzerland. Maybe the Netherlands, somewhere in Europe. Denmark. All right, so missing all over the place. But yeah, one person from North Carolina, one person from Denmark, Emily and Brian. Got a couple of records out, but their new album is out. It's called Daggers. And this track, White Noise, you can find pretty easily. I think you might be able to download it. I'll put a link for it. Really, really good song. White Noise by X-Cops.
Oh, noises, white noises, white noises talking to me. White noises, white noises, white noises, what should we do to me?
White Noise by X-Cops, and yeah, a little bit of a shoegazy indie rock track there. And that is it for this week's Most People DJs. Really appreciate listening. Come back for another episode, maybe another couple weeks or so. I'll come back with some pop culture stuff to talk about. I've been watching a lot of those superhero TV shows, and I want to get some reaction to that. So I will talk to you in a couple weeks.